Hello and welcome to Ask BR. This week we're talking about O Kadhal Kanmani. Rishi wants to know, my mom's generation loved most of Mani Ratnam's movies like Monoragam to Roja and so forth, but they aren't able to connect to his latest films. I've heard this from a lot of people, and I think one thing that happened is that his storytelling pattern changed a lot after Iruvar. He became a lot more ambitious in the cinematic sense. So what the earlier stories were somewhat simpler, the appeals to emotion were more direct, whereas now, because he's trying to tell a lot through a very cinematic manner, the emotional directness is not so much. There are other strengths, many other strengths, but I think the earlier films feel simpler and more grounded because of that, and I think that's why people, you know, sometimes feel that there's been a big change. Where do you place O Kadhal Kanmani in the trilogy, romantic trilogy Mani Ratnam made? See, I am of the generation which, I think there are three generations of Mani Ratnam love stories fans. One is the Monoragam generation, one is the Alai Paide generation, and one is the O Kadhal Kanmani generation. I am obviously from the Monoragam generation. And the thing I'm trying to say is that if I say I liked O Kadhal Kanmani, but I don't think it's a great film, I know that there are younger people who can kind of say, I can't understand what the fuss is about Monoragam. I don't know why everybody keeps talking about it. So it's also a generational thing, you know, what works, you know, at one point in time versus what works in another. But why Monoragam works for me is that the character of Divya is a very everyday kind of character, somebody that you'd find like right next door to you. So it was very easily identifiable, relatable, and we have seen people like that in our own homes. And whereas something like it's, in fact, if you look at it, it's the same character as the Nithya Menen character in O Kadhal Kanmani, where this girl is saying, I don't want to get married, I want to be alone, and there is a past which kind of determines why she does not want to get married and things like that. But what happened is, because of this change of style of Mani Ratnam, instead of a series of incidents that mark Revati's progression from I don't want to live with you to I want to live with you, we get a series of vignettes in O Kadhal Kanmani, which make the transition from I just want a light casual thing to I want a serious relationship. So when you put things in vignette form, it's more of a, like, you feel it, whereas with Monoragam, you're able to chart it more concretely, which is why I think some people, you know, kind of relate better to one film compared to the other one. The intensity of conflicts between central characters in Alai Paide was a lot less than in Monoragam, even less in OKK. Could this be because of the times have changed? I think it's because, in Monoragam, like I said, it was very clear cut. You know, both of them had a bit of ego in which she wanted to say, I want you to ask me to stay. And he's like, why don't you tell me that you don't want to go? So there's a little bit of that coming into the relationship. And there, the personal drama was between the two people, that is Mohan and Revati, and the entire drama was built around them. Whereas here, the real emotional drama is built around the couple outside of the central couple. So the real emotional stuff is happening between Leela, Samson, and the Prakash Raj characters. So I think, you know, that's also a way of commenting the way that the emotions have been shunted off, the deeper emotions, if you will, have been shunted off from the younger couple to the older couple, kind of makes a difference. And I think that may be a sign of the changing times. Live-in as a concept is not really accepted per se by Indian society. How do you think OK Kanmani managed to normalize the concept without giving rise to outrage? I don't think OK Kanmani is about a live-in relationship as such. Yes, they do, it is a live-in relationship, but it's about basically two people who think they don't want a serious commitment, and when charting the progression to the point that they realize that they would rather be with each other than without. So the live-in is one part of this, it's kind of folded into this, but that is not the whole movie. So I don't think that it managed to normalize live-in, because that's kind of a very different kind of movie. This was not that movie at all. Aditya says, I sort of liked the movie, but the ending was hypocritical to the rest of the movie, because the main character spent the entire movie standing up to their parents and all that, and he doesn't understand why they decide to get married in the end. Well, again, I think, you know, it's you know, it's after Gujarat, they spend the night in that lodge in Gujarat and they come back. You can kind of sense that, you know, Dulquer is losing his heart to her, you know, he kind of doesn't want to let her go. And they push it as far as they can, you know, in the casual sense before, you know, they don't want to admit it to themselves, let alone to each other. But then finally they realize that they would rather, you know, even they want to be with each other, you know, because the emotions get deeper and they want to be with each other. So in the end, the marriage is not a compromise for me, because they're not like vehemently against marriage. She's kind of, it's a bit of a defense mechanism for her, because she's like, okay, my dad and mom did this to me, so I don't think I want to be in a marriage. But that's, you know, those kinds of intellectual decisions sometimes kind of are defeated by more emotional happenings in your life. And that's what happens with her, where she realizes that she likes Adi a lot. And, you know, she sees the way he's behaving towards Ganapati uncle and Bhavani auntie. And she kind of knows that he's a nice guy, and she wants to kind of be with him. So I don't think the ending is a serious compromise. It's just a transition from earlier they were like this and now they are like that. Just like in Maunaragam, you know, earlier Revati says she does not want to get married, and then later she finally ends up with this guy. She kind of, that same kind of transition is what we are seeing. Shiva Karthik says, underneath Mani Ratnam's apparently progressive surface lies a heteronormative conservative outlook of life. I also believe he's a master of craft with a lightness and deftness of touch that no one in mainstream Indian cinema can quite yet grasp. I don't quite agree with your first one that, yes, I mean, definitely heteronormative and conservative outlook maybe, but I don't see why that is not progressive. I mean, is it only that if you show a homosexual relationship that one can be called progressive? I don't think so. People come with certain amounts of, I guess, you know, one's upbringing and the times one's born in and stuff like that. And also the consideration of what works with the society at large kind of dictates the relationships one puts forth on screen. So I think, you know, I don't think that's necessarily a regressive thing, you know, but I do believe that, yes, the second part, he is a master of his craft with the lightness and deftness of touch. You know, if you watch the hospital scenes in Kartrivilidai, the early scenes, the silence, the mood, the way the entire thing is staged, which kind of set up with the which kind of contrasts with the violence that happens later on, the quietness, everything is like silk, and that is a serious, I mean, the minute that happens, you know that this is no ordinary filmmaker. I want to make one point very clear. When I keep saying that Mani Ratnam is such a fantastic filmmaker, a lot of people think that I'm also saying that all his films are fantastic. That's not the case. Because even in a less than satisfactory film, you can still be a very, very good director in the terms that you stage the scenes, in the terms that everything is getting across, in the way the actors are placed and positioned and all those kinds of things. Where I think the problems lie in is some of his later films is in the material, the writing, not so much as a director, because I don't think, you know, there are many directors that are equal to him in the country today. There's a fan theory that the Mohan Revati couple from Maunaragam are either the Arvind Swami Khushbu couple in Alle Paide or the Prakash Raj Leela Samson thing. Actually, there's a lot of, you know, I've seen this a lot, but for me, my fan theory is that if you push the Siddharth and Trisha characters from either, you know, you will get Adi and Tara, because, you know, in that both of them are these very cool young couple. They kind of don't want to kind of, just like if you push the Inba and Shashi characters from either, you get the characters from Kartrivelidai. Because Trisha and Sid, both of them don't want to get married. They're both very cool. She's actually engaged to someone else and she's kind of flirting with this guy. And I think this is kind of a what if kind of situation where you extrapolate. It's kind of fun to do that with some filmmakers. Ashwin Lal is disappointed with the Hindi remake, OK Janu. Why didn't it work? Because the cast was wrong. The pair just did not have the chemistry of Nithya Menon and Dulquer Salmaan. And the theme is also not that revolutionary when you talk about it in terms of Hindi cinema, because when you think of Salam Namaste, that was in the early 2000s, and that was already talking about a live-in relationship, the woman gets pregnant and all that kind of stuff. So just that alone, you know, did not seem that, of material, that kind of material did not seem that new in a Hindi milieu. Arun Preeti Pillai says, we get trains and rains in most Manisar films. Can you elaborate a bit about his work with mirrors? How significant? I'm going to quote two passages from conversations with Mani Ratnam. One is when I asked him about the trains, he says he couldn't figure this out himself. I guess a train gives me a nice way to tell a story, like a journey. I also think because Mani Ratnam, as I told you, because he's always thinking of how to stage the scene and push it to the maximum extent possible so that the impact is visually there. You know, trains are kind of part of the tools that he uses to kind of impact this. Similarly, mirrors are, a tool that he uses. He said, I like mirrors because they're a beautiful device to tell the story, to visually present it, to stage a scene. They give the feeling of talking to yourself, like that scene in Bombay where Manisha talks to herself in the mirror. The mirror has you do what in literature a paragraph or a monologue can do. And what also happens is that creates certain, it's like you're seeing one person and suddenly there's two people, because in the scene, it alters the visual dynamics of the scene. So again, from a director's point of view, they're a great tool to use. Vineet says, hi sir, although I think OKK is a great neat film, I'd rather watch Kartribilde and Ravan join the club or even cuddle over it any day, even if they are flawed. Having read your reviews, I believe you felt something similar. Why? Now the thing is, I think the difference we're talking about is perfect films versus problematic films. What I mean there is when a film is OKK has smaller ambitions and it kind of tides through those ambitions in a fairly neat fashion. So when you walk away from the film, there's a kind of a complete feeling, you know. But I can't watch it again and again, like too many times. Whereas the Kartribilde or Ravanan or Kadhal kind of movie, which have problems in terms of characters or narratives or something like that, but the scenes that work are so good that you kind of keep going back to them, either to study how cinematically they are useful. Or I mean, cinematically they are doing a good job. Or there's just so much to see in each scene. For example, I mean, in terms of craft, let me just say, in Kartribilde, there's a scene that I caught only during the third or fourth viewing. You know, when the Karthi character is talking to his friend at a bar, and he's facing a mirror, and this is just after he has ditched Aditi at the registrar office after telling that he'd be there, and she is standing beside him and people are moving across behind him, and we see that in the mirror, and she is standing behind him, and this is revealed only after like a particular set of characters move. The scene choreography is so beautiful that you kind of realize that she's been there, but he's not seen her, just like we've not seen her either. This kind of thing, you know, it's so dense in his later films that you just can keep talking about events like these. Raja Selvam says, watched the movie plenty of times, but still wondering about Adi's disappearance after A. Sinamika, why he was kept in jail for 3 days. You know, actually, I couldn't figure this out either the first time I watched it. But I think what happens is Mani Ratnam wants the audio to be fairly reflective of the way people speak in real life. So sometimes it gets muffled and things are not clear. You know, what I'm talking about is other directors will choose audibility over naturalness. This is here, it's the other way around. So sometimes things get muffled, because even the first time when Adi sees Tara across the platform, she's actually saying something like, you don't want to get married, no? Okay, go, or something like that. That's not immediately apparent because the sounds of the trains are coming across and all that is mixed in. Here what happens is, I think Adi's character wanted to kind of research what it is like to be in jail for 3 days is what I got. I'm still not really sure about, you know, what happened there. But yeah, that was not very clear for me either when I watched it. Why do we have a reason for Tara's attitude towards marriage, parents, divorce when we don't have one for Adi? And do you think the mainstream audience, Mani Ratnam is apprehensive about a mainstream audience accepting a female lead who doesn't want to marry without a reason? This happened all the way back in Maunaragam also, but here it's a little different, I think, because, you know, if you see the Tara character, when they go to that lodge in Gujarat, just before that, she says, I don't know if I'll be able to control myself with you around. And later after that, when she takes him to her hostel room, she has absolutely no hesitation on her part when she invites him over for sex. So I don't think, you know, that if a filmmaker had been worried about whether audience will accept her reasoning, I don't think these things would have been shown. So I just think, you know, we have a fairly, it's more like, you know, when you see it as the development of the Revati character here, you're just seeing a different facet of her, so that one thing is a link between them rather than anything else. Why does this film look like Mani sir's take on the male-female relationships in today's society? I think we just talked about that. Prakash Raj's inclusion in the society felt like moral policing and justification of the director's thoughts, your take. No, I don't think it is moral policing, because it's a point of view. Like in Nayagan, if you see, Kamalasan's daughter, she kind of puts forward a point of view which is the moral point of view. She becomes the moral center of the story. Just because she's saying it, it doesn't mean that is Mani Ratnam saying it. It means that there is another point of view existing within the universe of the same story. Similarly here, had Mani Ratnam really wanted to make Prakash Raj a moral police, I think it would have been far more, forceful. And just here, there's just one scene when Adi brings Tara over and says, "I want we want to live together." I think that's the only point where he expresses reservation. Nowhere else. Elsewhere, he's actually playing along with Adi when the brother comes and they're pretending that she is actually Prakash Raj's niece. He's playing along with her. So I don't think it's moral policing at all. The Prakash Raj character is shown as someone who's strict and Mushide, why he allows Tara to stay with Adi when she just sings a song along with his wife, was it convincing? See, this is where I'm talking about the earlier Mani Ratnam might have probably staged a small scene to kind of explain this to the audience, whereas now he's content to just let a song play out. And we've already established that Prakash Raj, as you know, the most important thing to Prakash Raj is his wife. And when he sees that his wife is kind of softening towards this girl and kind of she's melting towards her, his feelings for his wife kind of get mixed up with the whole thing, and he's like, his eyes soften. You know, this Prakash Raj's performance in this film is so wonderful. We are so used to seeing a loud Prakash Raj in so many films that we forget how wonderful he can be. Another wonderful scene is when Leela Samson gets lost for the first time, and after that she goes, she's put in that MRI machine or whatever machine that is, and Prakash Raj is watching, and we cut to his face. It's not alarm, it's not sadness, it's a kind of he gives us this acceptance kind of smile, okay, this is the beginning of the end kind of thing. It's one of the most beautiful reaction shots I've seen. He loves his wife that much, and when she softens towards Tara, he kind of softens as well. That's all there is to it. So Mani Ratnam does not make an elaborate "this is why" out of it. He just lets the scene play out and lets you take away whatever you want from it, which is why I'm saying that some people don't, when all these questions are not exactly answered, some people feel a kind of dissatisfaction with this compared to a more cleanly narrated story like Maunaragam. OK Kanmani accepted by the audience, Kartravelli was not. I felt the nativity was lacking in Kartravelli Day. Similarly, there's another question. This film is a departure from Ratnam's more idiosyncratic style of filmmaking he has developed of late. Whenever he tries to go beyond these picture postcard movies, his films are usually rejected at the box office. See, I don't think it's the nativity in Kartravelli Day so much as the love story. I thought the movie was sold like in a manner that did not reflect what it was actually about, because it is a story of domestic abuse. It is not a love story. It is a love story in a loose sense, but it is actually a story of two very complicated people being in love. Now that, when it's sold with the kind of beautiful visuals and stuff like that, it makes audience expect a certain thing. Just like Kadhal was also kind of sold as some kind of love story, and the promotion said, Karthik's son, Radha's daughter, you expect Alegalo Vidale part 2, and the film is nothing like that. So I think sometimes the marketing also kind of oversells a movie and makes it seem like something it's not. But also, Karthi's casting, I think, was really, like, it went wrong in that film, simply because when you have a big actor like Karthi, a well-loved actor like him, to cast him in this kind of role is actually a bit of a problem, because audience kind of will take some things from some actors and will not take some things from some actors. When an actor is like Kamal Haasan and he's kind of proved time and again that he will do anything, then it's fine, because then the audience goes to his films to see something different. Here, Karthi has not yet established that kind of a body of work, and he's mostly played a kind of a good guy, and to suddenly kind see him here in a character that is also has certain problems in the way the character is developed, I think really threw people off, and they didn't want to see Karthi as this kind of fairly unlikable guy. The other thing is also that, I think movies like Ravanan or the Kartravelli Day are intimate dramas, and I think sometimes when the scale kind of comes up, there's there's a bit of a, you know, we have a bit of a problem adjusting with the expansiveness of the scale versus the intimacy of the emotions. That also kind of plays a part in why these films are usually not accepted typically. But I think it's also when directors working within the mainstream, which is most of Tamil cinema, think of concepts beyond what is traditionally accepted in the mainstream, they almost always face trouble getting accepted. Because if you look at even Selvaragavan, a Kadhal Kondain is accepted because it still fits within a mainstream format. There is a boy, he is in obsessive love with a girl, and you know how he is. So there is a traditional hero villain format, and we do have a tradition of this kind of thing. Whereas An Ayiruthuluvan is rejected simply because that's too out there. You know, I'm not, film may have some problems in itself, but it's not even given a chance because, you know, it's too out there and it's so different that people have trouble, like the average person has trouble wrapping his or her head around it. I think that's what happens there. Tyagaraja finds that, you know, there are some narrative issues in the screenplay, particularly with Kadhal and Ravan. You know, why should Ravanan fall in love with Aishwarya in the background of his sister's brutal death? I didn't think that was a particular problem because, you know, he is a person who... he did not, it's not love at first sight or something like that. He kidnaps her because he hates her husband. But when she shows, when she defies him and she says, this is one of the most beautiful scenes of a woman in Mani Ratnam's films. I mean, he always great women characters in his films. But for me, one of my favorite scenes in the, in his entire work is, she says, who are you to kill me? I'm going to, you know, I'll, my death is in my hands. And she kind of jumps. And that is when he transforms because he's like, wow, that's the kind of defiant spirit that, that really captures him. And, you know, that's another great moment of visual storytelling in the sense of she's, you know, he falling in love with her as she falls. You know, that kind of pretty much, you know, it explains why he falls for her. Again, another moment that is not explained seriously, like an earlier Mani Ratnam would have, but is shown cinematically. And so probably not, you know, that easily understood. I feel Kaattu Vilade is more of a Mani Ratnam film comparing the complexity of VC as compared to the simple surface level characterization of Dulquer Salmaan in OK Kanmani. What is your take? Yeah, there is no inner life to Dulquer, the character. He's very sweet and nice and sorted and all. But you know, for me, that when you look at Roja, for instance, Arvind Swamy finds, like, he seems like a typical software engineer, right? But when push comes to shove, he kind of falls on the flag, which kind of is saying that, you know, he has a different kind of persona to him. Now, that scene per se does not work for me, but you know that I'm talking about the character itself. There are layers to his character. Similarly, Talapathy, you have a character that's conflicted between family and a love and, you know, like a friend, a very loyal friend, a friendship is there. So, you know, that's what it is. And that complexity is not there in Dulquer, which is why I think it doesn't grab me as much in terms of repeated viewings. A setting almost decides how the story is going to be narrated. Do you think Mumbai was an important character in the film? I think Mumbai is important for a couple of reasons. One is it alienates the issue and makes it easier for them to find a house to live in together. And the second thing is, I think, you know, it makes him, we need, if Aditya's Anna and Anni are right next door to him, it's going to make the situation more complicated. So it actually makes sense that he's away from his immediate family so that the story can unfold in peace. So I think, yeah, and also I think Mumbai has always been an important character in many Mani Ratnam films, and this continues the tradition. He knows the color, he knows what it is to be an outsider in that place because he studied there and all kinds of things. So I think even from a history point of view, there's a great value to Mumbai as a character. Amidst all the badly written female characters, this film does a decent job of portraying an independent, fearless, opinionated, urban contemporary woman. Your thoughts? Yes, there's a long line of that. There's Revati in Maunaragam, there's the Roja character, a villager. Even she's not an urbane character, but she has that strength in her to kind of fight for her husband. There's Aishwarya Rai and Guru, another character who's not really an urban character, but who kind of finds it enough to stand by her husband through thick and thin. So that's really something that you find consistently in Mani Ratnam's films. Why does that Ninga in the Adiketa Ketrakalan confrontation scene between Anni and Nithya make such a memorable impression as a cry for feminism rather than most monologues on the same topic do? It's simple because he's not making a point or a message. He's not making the character carry a placard. This this is the character. She's like, don't mess with me. That's what her character is. And it comes across as a part of the character rather than as a message from the voice of the director. So that's why the scene works. It makes you feel for her and by extension her generation. Your review mentioned that O Kadhal Kanmani is an unapologetic upper class movie. What does it mean? I think what I meant is that these characters are very, the movie is very true to the milieu of the class and the characters in terms of, you know, whether it's Carnatic music in a very pure form, or you know, the Louis Vuitton bag that Tara's mom buys her and things like that. What I'm saying is usually filmmakers feel a little apologetic when they show these upper class people. So they kind of have a sidekick who probably does enna machi idu pandreya, you know, and probably take him to a bar or something like that to kind of bring in a different kind of flavor to the thing. Here that never happens because Adi is like that, Adi's friends are like him, Tara is like is the same type, Tara's friends are like her, their boss is the same. Everybody belongs in an upper class milieu, which and that's why I think the film works to the extent that it does, because it is true to that particular milieu. I think A.R. Rahman's BGM and songs played a big role. It was very refreshing. Yeah, I think the sounds that Rahman used were very, very refreshing and young, and they added a lot of youthfulness to what Dulquer and Nithya were already adding to that scene. So especially when you look at the church scene or the first telephone call that when she calls him, the sounds that he uses, they're so like young and uplifting, and I think that really works. There's a question about the Alaipayade's extensive use of song and dance versus OK Kanmani's songs largely being in the background with very little choreography. I think it's not that Alaipayade is an out-and-out musical, because if you look at Sinamika, it's very much like Kadhal Sadugudu. If you look at Yevano Oruvan in Alaipayade, there is no choreography there. It's within the scenes only. Pache Nirame, yes, is extensively choreographed. But then I think Mani Ratnam is also one person who kind of says, I've been there, done that, I don't want to do it again. So he keeps trying to see if there are new ways to kind of show things like love and other things. So instead of Pachini Rame, where he's expressing his love through colors, here Mental Manadil is kind of beginning that whole thing where it's the youthfulness of the whole situation is shown through them riding through a city on a bike and stuff like that. So it's just a different way of showing the same thing. How important was Prakash Leela Samson pair in the climax? If not for them, would these two realize true companionship? Yes, they do provide a contrast, a more permanent kind of relationship to the temporary thing, one that these guys are seeking. But I also feel that, you know, it's not just them. They are an important part, yes. But it's also the feelings that develop within themselves, within Adi, within Tara, because he kind of begins to snap at her towards the end because he's kind of upset about the fact that she's going away, and she doesn't tell him that she's got that admission to Paris because she kind of doesn't want to break it to him or make that thing final. So that whole thing is more than just Prakash Raj and Leela Samson being there. It's more than that. You recently mentioned that it's hard to like recent works of Mani Ratnam if one is not a fan of filmmaking itself. Is OK Kanmani an exception to that trend? How does it differ from other Mani Ratnam films in terms of filmmaking craft? Well, I think, if you look at OK Kanmani, there is, because the scenes are meant to be light and kind of thing, there isn't much of staging here in terms of developing the characters as well. But there's one lovely scene where the door is a little ajar when this young couple is eavesdropping on the older couple, and then that same thing is repeated later. First, we see the older couple with the door ajar and the camera turns 180 degrees, and then we see the same alignment of doors towards this couple also, which kind of shows them, you know, we are eavesdropping on them now and they seem to be having the same kind of loving conversation that the older couple. So it's a kind of hint that they are going to end up in the same space as the older couple, you know, because we visually kind of made that equation. That's kind of what, this Mani Ratnam is all about. It's not that it wasn't there earlier. You had stupendously staged scenes earlier also. But I'm saying that this is the scenes that replace a lot of the narrative like this. So it kind of, it's a change. Like in Ravanan, when he's kind of going round and round in that boat, he's his head is spinning at the sight of her, you know. You can kind of take away that from that scene. Or when Kartu Velida is there's a beautiful scene where Aditi says she's pregnant, and as long as VC is looking at her face, her eyes, you know, and kind of going down her body, he's happy. But the minute he looks up and sees his face in the mirror, he's, because he hates himself, there's a lot of self-loathing in him. So the minute he sees his face, his whole attitude towards having the baby changes, and he realizes, oh my God, I cannot be happy at this moment because I'm this horrible person. And that is what triggers him. So again, those kinds of things are really like wonderful to see. Do you think Mani Ratnam's novelty has worn off as the advent of new filmmakers with story-oriented content? I don't think it's story-oriented content, but I think the newness of a filmmaker definitely wears off after a time, which is why, you know, Mani Ratnam himself keeps trying newer ways of telling the stories instead of saying, this work, this kind of, I'm just going to repeat that over and over again. A great example, a parallel example in Hollywood is Steven Spielberg. You know, at one point he was the wunderkind. He was, he was cutting edge in everything and everybody. But then, you know, newer generations of filmmakers start coming in. And today, if you look at The Post, it's a superbly directed film, you know. It's so beautifully directed. The shots are to die for. But people don't talk about it that much. They kind of, you know, because there are more exciting films, which kind of do more cool things or younger things or whatever. So the classical mode of filmmaking that Spielberg favors is kind of, you know, is people respect it, but at the same time, it's not top of the mind anymore because they've been seeing this for a long time. And I think there's a bit of a taken for granted thing also that comes through, that, oh, it's Spielberg, of course the film is going to be well made kind of thing. So I think that's one thing. The other thing is also that, you know, the Mani Ratnam films typically come with so much hype that I don't think that can be justified by, even if, it's very, very hard for a film to live up to that kind of pre-release hype. And I'm talking about a lot of the big films these days. I think that also, plays a part. And when you combine this with the fact that the fate of a film is decided within the first 15-20 minutes, which is when people start tweeting out saying, "Ayo, the Panam Sama Mokkada," kind of things, you know, you're pretty much, if it's a serious film that requires a bit of concentration and a little bit of involvement, you've pretty much lost the audience right then and there. So I think that's a number of these things kind of play into the equation. Last question is that OKK lacked any real conflict usually associated with Mani Ratnam romance, but it compensates with music, aesthetics and all that. It's a decent movie, but can you put it in the win column of The Man Who Made Nayagan? I think I would definitely put it in the win column for one simple reason, is that how many directors in their 60s would you know can put together a story as young and as fresh as OK Kanmani? I mean, I don't think there is anybody, in India right now that has lasted this long for over 3 decades and still been a director at the top of his craft. Again, note that I'm making the distinction between a director and a writer. A director, the technical person who stages scenes with his crew, tries to make everything come alive from paper to the big screen. That way I'm talking about, and that, you know, he's been doing that consistently for 30 years and made a film as young as OKK, which people are still talking about. So I think that is an amazing achievement in itself. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, do subscribe to Film Companion South.